Here's Crosby going right through Crosby. Goal. He shoots and scores as he beats Colsey like a rented mule.
Well, what makes this job in Pittsburgh unique is the people, the talent that they have in this hockey club. I mean, every night I get a chance to watch the best players maybe in the National Hockey League.
When it comes to Crosby, throw it right back in front and just missing with Chatan going down the slot.
Well, when you look at the Penguin roster, I mean, obviously, Sidney Crosby stands out to you as being a possibility to being one of the great, great players of all time in the National Hockey League.
Cora, stutter step over to Malkin. In front, a quick shot by Benetenko. He makes it 2-1 Pittsburgh. Another brilliant pass by number 71, Malkin.
Don't forget Evgeny Malkin, too. These are two guys that are really special, special players.
They make passes like that. It's like, I mean, that's some Mario passes.
It is.
Just, I mean, goodness gracious.
Well, when you talk about the greatest player of all time, I mean, Lemieux certainly is in that category. To me personally, I mean, he is the greatest goal scorer that's ever played the game.
He shoots and scores! Mario Lemieux beats Malt like a rented mule.
Mario had the hands of gold. I mean, everything he touched just was perfect and beautiful.
He left it on the parkway going to the airport. Brilliant goal.
We've had 66, and nobody else did. We get down to the last game of the 90 season, and we're in the playoff hunt. Buffalo comes back in the final game of the season, and they beat us in overtime. We don't. But because of not winning that game, we have the fifth choice overall in the draft that year, and that gentleman was Jaromir Jagr. And now another part of the puzzle starts to come together.
Jagr goes coast to coast, and a goal! He shoots and scores! He beats Timo like a rented mule.
After we won the cup in Minnesota, the first cup, obviously we're in the mood to celebrate. And at one point, Craig Patrick gets on the loudspeaker and talking because he wanted to tell everybody that, guys, we're not going to be able to go to our cars where we had them because there's people jamming up the roads in Pittsburgh on the Parkway West. And we're not gonna be able to get to our cars. They've actually closed the parkway down. Yeah, right, Craig. Sure they did, yeah. No, I'm telling you the truth. We're gonna have to try and get some buses and then be able to try and get back and get our cars tomorrow. Yeah, right, Craig, okay. So when we got off the plane, obviously, we were just stunned by the response of the people.
Please rise, light your candles to join us for this special memoriam to our good friend and coach, Bob Johnson.
The tribute to Bob Johnson happened on November 27, 1991. It was after, of course, Badger had led the Penguins to their first Stanley Cup, and brain cancer took his life. And so the Penguins, after he passed away, had a tribute to him in the arena that night. The love, really, basically, that was shown for Bob Johnson. If you weren't moved that night, even watching your television, you'll never be moved in your life. And then the Penguins had their second chance to go for the Stanley Cup, and that was in 1992 against the Chicago Blackhawks. This was game one of the finals. The Hawks come out, and they just smoked Pittsburgh physically. They were up 3-0 in the game. The Penguins found a way to kind of find their equilibrium, and with about 5 minutes to go, Jaromir Jagr scores the goal of the decade there. I mean, he just comes off the boards and makes an incredible play to tie it. And the Penguins end up in the final seconds with a face-off in the Chicago zone. And Mario goes to the front of the net, and there's nobody around him. He grabs a rebound and puts it in the cage. And the place just goes literally ballistic. It went right through your whole body and literally made you stand up. And the greatest goal ever scored, I think, in the history of this franchise was that one in game one. Every other day when you get in the playoffs, you're playing, and the whole city's involved. And then you do it.
The Penguins have won the Stanley Cup. Oh, Lord Stanley, get me the brandy.
Those moments will be with me for the rest of my life. I mean, great, great moments.
And there goes Lemieux, carrying the Stanley Cup around. It'll come back to Pittsburgh.
In 1996, Mario's son, Austin, was born prematurely, and Mario played against the St. Louis Blues. I don't know if subconsciously or just the fate of somebody above, Lemieux just went to work. And he ended up with 5 goals against the Blues.
And he's going to get a chance for number 4. Lemieux went on Casey. He walks in his shot. Hey!
everybody just realizing that, you know, here was Mario and he was doing this for Austin. And he just stepped back and went to a different stratosphere.
Passing to Francis just on to Lemieux in front. There he is. Lemieux's fifth of the night.
The Penguins had not been to the finals for quite some time, but in 2008, they got the chance to go back against the Detroit Red Wings, and they were faced with elimination in Detroit, and the Penguins were able to somehow get back into this hockey game in Game 5.
Crosby to the near corner, holds a shooter, save made, rebound, Talbot, hey! Johnson scores, Max Talbot, the Penguins have tied it at 3.
They went to the first overtime, hard fought. They went to a second overtime, and on the third overtime.
Comes back in behind the goal, Malkin, over to Sikora, wrist shot, score! The Penguins have won it! Peter Sikora scores, and the Penguins win in overtime! Oh, ladies and gentlemen, Elvis has just left the building.
Which puts the game really in the top five of all time for Penguin fans in the history of this franchise and what they accomplished. But a game that really, for the new generation of Penguin fans, one that they'll never, ever forget. In 2006, I came off the television side as they decided to make a change there, and I went back to radio, and of course, radio is where I started here with the Pittsburgh Penguins. I was not expecting what happened with the television part of it, but we've survived and we've moved on, and I decided the radio part of it, particularly for the people of Pittsburgh. They had asked me a lot after that happened to at least stay on and be the broadcaster for the radio side. And I'll continue it until I feel like I don't want to do it anymore. So that's where we are.
Go ahead, beat me like a running mule. Go ahead.
It ends when Mike Lange decides it ends. If I think that I need another challenge and something else, maybe I'll pursue that. If I still enjoy what I'm doing and I love the moment when I go to work, then I'll stay with it. But who knows? I mean, life's, you know, a lot of challenges could come up and a lot of things could be put in front of you that you might want to go a different direction. We'll just wait and see, find out how it happens.
Ladies and gentlemen, Elvis has just left the building.